Number 8, Game of Thrones, Total War, Fire and Blood, by P-Man. So this mod has a lot of campaigns. We have the War of Conquest campaign, the new UI, similar to the one in Third Age Reforged, and there was another mod too that had that. Okay, we have the Fire and Blood campaign with a bunch of different campaigns. I don't dare clicking on all of them in a row because I believe it can crash when you click on too many at once. But you have the Fate Militant Uprising, you have the Rogue Prince, you have the Dance of Dragons, you have the Conquest of Dawn, you have the First Blackfyre Rebellion, you have the Third Blackfyre Rebellion, you have the Fourth Blackfyre Rebellion, you have the War of Nine Penny Kings, you have Robert's Rebellion, you have Greyjoy's Rebellion, you have the War of Five Kings, and you have A Storm of Swords, and you have A Feast for Crows, and you have Winds of Winter. As far as I know, the new show about the Targaryens are about... pretty sure that's the Dance of Dragons here. And then Robert's Rebellion, that was the... what had happened in the past during the show. Same with the Greyjoy's Rebellion, so that's prior to the show, but not long ago. It was like few years ago when Ned Stark and Robert Baratheon and Sita, they were young. Okay, so their flashback scenes are from these two events. And then we have the War of Five Kings, the war of the show between the kings, Renly, Rob, Stannis, Joffrey, and Balon Greyjoy, King of the Irons. Okay, and then we have Storm of Swords, and the Feast for Crows, and Winds of Winter. And this is the mod you should play if you want the style of the TV show and many different campaigns. Because Game of Thrones Total War Enhanced do not have more than one campaign, while this mod has more. However, the War of Five Kings may be more polished in a Game of Thrones Enhanced. In this mod, however, he has a lot of different campaigns, and they are also more, what should I say, developed in certain areas. While they may have some different gameplay and scripts and such, they may also have more custom strat models on the map, and certainly this mod has more custom cities in battle too, 30 cities or more. So we could try a campaign, but we will go to multiplayer and hot seat and Fire and Blood, and we can go to the War of the Five Kings, and then we can pick two factions. We'll pick House Stark and House Bolton. I want two factions that are next to each other. So they can attack each other, because I just want to preview the map. We can see that this mod also has the maximum numbers of factions. It has 31 factions in the game, unlike Game of Thrones Enhanced, which had only like, I believe, 20 something factions, maybe less. But this mod has 31 factions, the maximum number, so together with the rebels, 31 factions, I believe, are the maximum number you can have in Medieval 2 Total War and its mods. And we saw that Westeros Total War 1.0 only had like 12 or 13 factions, and this mod has the 31 that is possible in the game. So we have the undead. Lore-wise, they should be named the others. I told Peeman that, but he didn't change it for some reason. But the others is the name in the books and in the show. They are not named the undead. They are the undead, of course, but they are named the others, not the undead. That's just something I thought about immediately when I saw this in earlier versions, because the undead That's not their name. Okay, the Free Folk, that's the Wildlings. So you can play the Free Folk here too. They have their heroes and they have at least 5 units. But as I said, the faction has too few units in my opinion and is better played in Game of Thrones Enhanced. We have the Night's Watch, we have the House Stark faction, we have House Bolton, we have House Frey, we have House Tully, we have House Arryn, we have House Lannister, we have House Greyjoy, we have the Crownlands, which is the Joffrey faction, we have House Baratheon, Stannis, and we have House Targaryen, which is the Daenerys faction, and House Targaryen with a yellow dragon, which is the Greens, and we have House Baratheon, I believe this is Renly in this campaign, we have House Tyrell, we have House Martell, and then we have some Essos factions, like Slaver's Bay, the Confederation, Three Daughters, and Volantis. And yeah, this mod is the one you should pick if you want many custom settlements in battle, if you want the maximum numbers of factions in the campaign, if you want many different options when it comes to campaigns, and also I believe that this faction is the faction you should play if you want all of Westeros and Essos on the map. You have 2 continents here, and unlike in the Italian mod, Essos is fully fleshed out. It has factions, it has terrain, it has resources, it's fully playable, it's not an empty continent with just grey land. Okay, let's start the game as the Boltons and House Stark now. Of course there is an intro video, we won't watch it here. He also has unique loading screens that I don't think fit, because the models and the style is based on the TV show, but the loading screens are based on the books, and I think you shouldn't mix style. I think you should have kept the Game of Thrones Enhanced loading screens, or at least have had the TV show loading screens. But of course it's cool with the stuff around the picture, Fire and Blood, Total War. I just don't like the picture in the middle, because it's not based on the show. Okay. So, Game of Thrones, Total War, Fire and Blood is yet another mod set in Westeros and based on Song of Ice and Fire. And of course it's a really well made mod. P-Man is very passionate about the mod. He has done a lot of work this year. He's working like a madman, adding new custom settlements to both battle and on the map. And he's working on 2 mods at once. Rise of Illyria, Total War, and this mod. This is the more developed mod, and the older mod out of the 2. Okay, let's start the campaign. Of course he has some of the scripts from Westeros 1.0, like the interactive supply lines. Let's just click yes on them. We can start, we can use toggle FAU to make the map visible. You see that this is a huge map, custom settlements on the map everywhere. Maybe not in Beyond the Wall, here it is vanilla, but he has custom resources, like for example this heart tree. They're really cool, he has placed out such things. The Wildling cities look like they are not custom. They're probably the only cities that are not custom, but the Wildlings in this mod are very unfinished. Probably won't be finished unless he removes something else, because 5 units, that's nothing. But we can see that Castle Black is custom, and other castles on the wall are vanilla. But he has a lot of custom cities on the map. Last Heart, for example. We have Carhold, we have the Dread Fort. We have Bear Island. Deepwood Mortar. We have Winterfell with a new model. And there's a new, his new princess models that he rigged too. So we are controlling Hal Stark currently. We have, unfortunately, Robb Stark is used by many heroes here, including Joyen Reed and Roderick Cassel, etc. I think he needs to fix that. So the problem is that he is using 16 different campaigns. So maybe if Robb is one in one campaign, might be duplicated for the others, I don't know. But this is the War of the Five Kings, where Robb should be the leader of House Stark, and there must be a bug causing him to be more than one general. Because it's possible to have him, you know, unique for Robb Stark, but here we seem to have him for every custom general. Okay, if you go out with Brandon, he too will be Robb Stark, so obviously all the generals are Robb Stark. That's a bug, I guess. You can see that the strat model for Winterfell is new. That's cool. He rigged his own model, and also in battle he has a completely unique model. It doesn't look exactly like this, but it looks more like the old strat model, the custom settlement in battle, and I prefer that look, to be honest. This one looked a little bit too artistic. Little bit too book style. I think it doesn't look as much as the TV show one as the old one, but this is probably closer to the books. Okay, and then we have other areas too. You can see that the map is huge, and that he has added a lot of minor house strat models. For example, here we have Leftford, here we have Marbrand. Many of these minor houses are in Game of Thrones Enhanced, but he has made a lot of additional minor houses that aren't in Game of Thrones Enhanced. And especially, he has made strat models for them that are not in Enhanced. So as I said, P-Man is very, very passionate about Westeros and Game of Thrones, and especially the show. So he spent a lot of time adding unique city strat models and unique general strat models to every faction for every minor house, etc. So that's why he has a lot of details that Game of Thrones Enhanced do not have, because we didn't bother adding a million strat models to the mod for the cities or the characters. Also, it's more difficult to add cities that are unique everywhere if you don't have 31 factions. I believe it's 31 factions, you can divide them between 31 cultures, but when you have 20 something factions, you have fewer options to divide them. Here we can see princess model of Cersei Lannister and Sansa Stark. He also has Margaery Tyrell somewhere. And besides princess models like that, based on real characters from the show, he has bunch of cool city models. Not I believe he has more custom models on the map than in battle, but still has like 30 plus cities in battle that are custom. It can be compared to 5 or something in Game of Thrones Enhanced. 4 to 5. Okay, so this mod is clearly the better one if you want more unique strat models for cities and generals. If you want more settlements in battle to be custom, if you want more campaigns, and if you want if you want more options, Game of Thrones Enhanced might have a more stable War of the Five Kings campaign, maybe. Maybe it has a slightly different gameplay too. Some people may prefer that gameplay over this mod's gameplay. But this mod is the most impressive. it's also the larger mod. It has Essos, we can see here. Volantis, three daughters. We have House Targaryen. The Yellow Dragon. We have Confederation holding Bravos. And we have Norvos. Kuhor. Dothraki, they are holding some areas too. The Dothraki. So their capital is Vase Dothrak. It's over there. Then we have, of course, Slaver's Bay. Holding the Harpy cities here. I don't believe they are custom in battle. They will probably make them at one point or another. Here we have a vanilla city. Here is where Daenerys start and Jorah Mormont, etc. Okay, so we have a bunch of factions and a larger world map. We have alliances and such. Okay, so this is a really impressive Game of Thrones mod that I highly recommend. And it's the 8th mod on my top 20 fantasy list mod for, fantasy mod list for Medieval Total War Kingdoms. And of course we want to check settlement in battle. So we have House Bolton here. He also has added new unit info cards for all his units and new unit cards. In older versions he used the same as in Game of Thrones Enhanced. I believe he's still using similar unit cards for some of the heroes, but he has remade all the unit cards and unit info cards, which is impressive. And he has new agents, even though he did share some agents and ships with Game of Thrones Enhanced, because we shared models, battle models with him, and unit cards and such. Of course, he has replaced most of them, as I said. Okay, so we have general here. This is a Ramsay Bolton model, yeah it is. That's pretty cool. Anyway, Winterfell is a bit far away, probably. Probably is there. We need to use Toggle Fow. Okay, and then we will click and turn. Need to reach Winterfell. I want to take a look at the settlement. It's the settlement most people wanted in the game. But we aren't there, you know. We had Winterfell on the strat map for since 2011 or something, but never had it in battle. Let's continue. Unfortunately, we need to move a lot. And instead of checking troops in battle that look very similar to Game of Thrones Enhanced troops, we will check the custom battle map of Winterfell. There are a lot of custom settlements here. We could have checked more, but including the Dreadfort, which is really cool. I've not played this mod before. I've tried an older version of it, but I've never really played this version. I was gonna play it, but ended up not playing, and I believe I tried the Targaryens a little bit when it released. But I haven't really played it, and yeah, I wanted to do some modifications on it first before playing as the Targaryens, because as I said, in this mod Daenerys is riding a horse, and in Game of Thrones Enhanced she's riding a dragon. I would like to have her ride a dragon here too. It's more fun when she rides a dragon. She's more strong, powerful with a dragon. It's boring if she has a horse, in my opinion. Anyway, we have reached the city, now we just need to start the battle. We couldn't start it immediately because we needed a ram. Okay. Could probably sally out. These guys could of course reinforce us. See here. Fuck. I fucked up. You know what I did? I have hot seat on and I forgot to disable that. There is an option that says if you want to play with real time battles or automatic battles. That is usually not checked, but in this mod for some reason it's checked. Hot seat, Fire and Blood. War of the Five Kings, and auto-resolve battles. It should never be checked, but for some reason it is checked in this mod. So now I couldn't start the battle, and now we need to redo everything. I think I will skip that. Could probably go to the settlement through the custom battle menu, maybe. We'll do that instead. Stark. By the way, we need to of course have the right settlement too. So we can so we have Site of King's Landing, we have Dragonstone. These are custom models. This settlement of King's Landing is in Game of Thrones Enhanced and in Westeros 1.0 as well. Dragonstone has been remade in this mod. It's a new and different Dragonstone. We have Winterfell. We have Mount Cailin. Mount Cailin is in Westeros 1.0 and was in Game of Thrones Enhanced, but crashed on Windows 10, so I removed it. We have some other areas too. Let's start the Winterfell battle. Add any fortress, okay. Let's see here. Site of Winterfell, add an E, North European fortress. European fortress. There is no option here. So I don't really know how to do it. We have no options. So we'll hope that it's checked automatically. Otherwise we will not have the settlement. Fuck, it crashed. So yeah, this mod is unstable. I believe Game of Thrones Enhanced is not free from crashing, but I believe this one is less stable. Okay, but I have this mod as the 8th mod on my list. And the reason it's above Game of Thrones Enhanced is because all the custom settlements and such. But when it comes to stability, I do believe that Game of Thrones Enhanced is actually more stable. Okay, but this is the 8th mod, we do not really have to look at it anymore. And we could instead take a fast look here, where we can see that he has added Storm's End. He has added Winterfell to the battle map. We have Harren Hall, really cool settlement. We have the Bloody Gate. We have High Garden. An actual custom settlement this time. We have the Twins. We have Aken Hall. Dread Fort, a really cool city model. Yeah, and so on. So, Game of Thrones lore, Fire and Blood. I think you should test both this mod and Game of Thrones Enhanced, and I don't know which one is more stable, but I do believe that Enhanced is the more stable one. Okay, but this one has all the cool settlements and strat models and such. Okay, let's continue with the next mod. Right guys, the next one on the list is a little bit different. It's Call of Warhammer, Beginning of the End Times. It's the number 7 on my top 20 list for fantasy mods of Medieval Total War Kingdoms. But this one is different. So, Beginning of the End Times is a sub-mod of Call of Warhammer, the other Warhammer mod that we checked, the one made by Russians. And this one is made by English-speaking modders, and they made a sub-mod out of the original Call of Warhammer mod, which became this one, Beginning of the End Times. This sub-mod, Beginning of the End Times, released originally in 2016 during the summer. And I believe this version 2.0, the 2.0 numbers are behind this recording program. I believe I'm using the NVIDIA recorder, and the symbol here is shown to show that the mod is recording, the tool is recording the mod. Okay, so we can't see the 2.0, but it's version 2.0. It's about 2 years old. I believe it released in November or December 2019. So this mod is a submod of Call of Warhammer, and it's different because if I were to rank it based on how polished it is, if I were to rank it based on how polished the mod is, and how many features many new animations it adds and such, then it would probably have been a top 5 mod. It would probably have been on place number 5 on the list, because this is the original Beginning of the End Times submod. But I base my list mostly on what I enjoy playing, and my opinion is that the other submod of Beginning of the End Times, Alternative Cut, is even better than this one. This one is more polished and has better balance and such, and is the original one. But I prefer Alternative Cut because it has, you can say this one has the original setup with 4 Chaos factions, a bunch of Empire factions and such, and Alternative Cut is removing most of the Empire factions, and I believe instead of having 10 different Empire factions, I believe that the submod Alternative Cut, which is a submod of Beginning of the End Times, that it removed them and instead added new factions that are completely new. And instead of 4 Chaos factions, you get I believe 3 Chaos factions. And then you get 3 orc factions and at least 3 undead factions, and then you get completely new factions like the halflings, the Amazons, the Tilia and Hystalia, etc. Arabi. Okay, so the point is that I prefer the other submod that has more unique factions. In this mod you have many of the same, like for example, as I said, 4 Chaos factions and 10 Empire factions. I believe 2.0 of this mod did remove, believe that 1 Empire faction was removed and something else, and that they added the Pestilence, Skaven and the Vampire Coast to this mod as well. But most of the Empire factions are still here. This mod, based on how polished it is and all the new animations it brought forth and so on, it would be number 5 on the list. But because I prefer Alternative Cut over this one, I placed Alternative Cut higher on the list. And also Warcraft Total War, well, it might not be as polished as this mod, I still prefer it over this mod, so I still placed it above this mod. Even though Warcraft of Lore is using animations from this mod, so without this mod it would have been impossible to add some of the units of the Warcraft mod. But as I said, it's my top 20 fantasy mods for Medieval Total War Kingdoms. Of course I will take into account any popularity on ModDB of said mods. In other words, I wouldn't place any mod higher than 3rd Age because it's the most popular mod. And I am trying to keep the list true to the rankings on ModDB.com for the most part. But if I think a mod is better than another mod, I might place it higher on my list, and that's the case here with Warcraft and Alternative Cut, that this mod might be more polished and might be the original beginning of the End Times mod that brought a lot of new animations and other features to the Medieval Total War modding community. And without this mod, the other two mods either wouldn't have existed or wouldn't have had nearly as good animations for the units. So you can say that this mod might be the more polished and more finished one out of the three, and therefore, based on how polished it is, should be number 5 on the list. But if I base it on which mod I actually like playing, then I prefer the other two over this one. So that's why this one is number 7 on my list. We can check the campaign, beginning of the End Times campaign. You can see that it has a bunch of factions. It has all the factions of the original Call of Warhammer except one Empire faction that has been removed in favor of the Pestilence Skaven. And then I believe another faction was removed as well. Maybe he removed two Empire factions in favor of the Skaven, the Pestilence Skaven, and the Vampire Coast. So in the original Call of Warhammer, I believe we had the Skaven, but they controlled areas in both the Old World and in the New World. And in this version, Beginning of the End Times 2.0, I believe also in the Old version of Beginning of the End Times, we had the same Skaven faction as in Call of Warhammer, the same Empire factions and such. But in the latest 2.0 beta of Call of Warhammer Beginning of the End Times, the Skaven were cut into two, so instead of having all of the Skaven being one faction, the Skaven of the Old World became the Skaven, and the Skaven of the New World became the Pestilence Skaven. And then the Vampire Coast is a new faction with new units and such, but some of the units are shared with the Sylvania Vampire faction. Okay, so we have the same factions as in Call of Warhammer, but I preferred how they were named in Call of Warhammer, the original mod. So instead of Rakeland, Visenland, etc., they had like Grand Barony of Rakeland, Grand Duchy, etc., etc. I believe that was more detailed, and I liked it more because here they have just removed the titles, so you don't know which one is a duchy, which one is a barony, etc. In that version, all of them had the correct titles before their faction name, so to speak. So you knew which one was a duchy and which one was a barony and such. So I think it was a bad idea to remove the longer names. I prefer having long names. They made it more simple here. Okay, then we have the factions. So in this version, we still have the minions of Saints, Warriors of Khorne, the Children of Nurgle, and the Cultists of Slaanesh. But in this version, Chaos Undivided is playable from the start. And the script to spawn them has been removed. And the same is true for other scripts that have been removed from the original game, because the developers of Beginning of the End Times didn't want a heavily scripted campaign. So you can't form the Chaos Undivided faction here. You can choose to place them, or you can place the others. So the others start with the same areas they had in the original game, and then Chaos Undivided has gotten some new areas, because we have a much larger map now that spans all of the Old World, and also the new world, but there are some areas down here that aren't present, of course. But it has a much bigger map, so. And this mod added a bunch of new factions. So. Added Pestle and Rats in this latest version. And. I believe the. What's the name? The Border Princes Confederacy. They have been renamed into the Dogs of War. Because that's their name from the tabletop games, I believe. Then we have Britonia, another new faction. The Karas Anchor faction has been renamed into Dwarves to make it more simple. I still believe that they should have kept the titles of the Empire factions and kept Karas Anchor, I mean. But Dwarves, it's, everyone knows that Karas Anchor is the Dwarves, in my opinion. Lizardmen is a new faction. High Elves are still in the game, but now they are in their own area. So they are not in the old world anymore. Same with the Dark Elves, they start in their own area. We have the Wood Elves, start over here. Anyway, the Lizardmen, they start here. There is small symbols here when you click on the factions. So you can see where they start. Britannia starts over here. Britannia, actually. Water Princess down there. Pestilence Skaven over here. The original Skaven starts here. Okay, and then with the Tomb Kings down here. Vampire Coast, they start over there. And then we have the Vampire Counts. And we have the Ogre Kingdoms. Down there. And we have the Night Goblins. So there are a bunch of factions to play as. And the new faction in this mod was the Vampire Counts, Vampire Coast, so we can check them out. Okay, let's start the campaign. I mean, the Pestle and Skaven, they are mostly the same as the Skaven in terms of their units. They have some new units, but most of the roster is still the same. The Vampire Coast also is sharing some units with the Sylvania faction, but they are more unique than the Pestilence Skaven, in my opinion. You'll have to excuse my poor English language. I recently ate breakfast and for some reason I have trouble speaking. My throat is a little bit dry. So the Ogre Kingdoms has a horde script. Here we have the Vampire Coast. So we have unique strat models too. This could be expected. We have Sirens, a new unit. Zombie Deckhands. Zombie Gunner Mobs. New faction members, etc. So we're not going to check the faction. It's not a what should I say, it's oh, this is a deck zombie deck gunner unit. Pretty cool. But we will toggle FAV on the map. See that the map is huge. Much bigger than in the Call of Warhammer mod. And with many new factions and such. This mod has been out since 2016, but the latest version was released in late 2019. So, about 2 years old now. And this mod is the most popular Warhammer mod for Medieval Total War Kingdoms. And some people would say that it's better because it's more polished than the alternative cut version. And also that it's better than Warcraft Total War because it's more polished. But in my opinion, on my list, because I base the list on which mods I prefer playing as well, and that's why I placed the other two above this. But this one is still impressive, and if you check the factions in custom battle, see that there are 31 factions, so way more factions to pick from compared to the old God of Warhammer mod. It's the maximum number of factions available to players in both the campaign and in custom battle. And if you check the factions, the Dark Elves, and we can check someone else too. We can check the Vampire Coast and the Pestilence Skaven. Check them. You can see that the Witch Elves have been changed. They have white hair here in the latest version. And we have new units. We have Hydras. We have new Cold Ones, I believe. Cold One Chariots. We have Black Dragons, and they have been improved compared to in the old version. I believe compared to the old version of Beginning of the End Times, there were no dragons in the original Call of Warhammer for the Dark Elves. And this one is improved, I believe. We have better animations for the Cold One Knights too. And the veteran Cold One Knights. Especially the Hydra is much better here. It has unique animations, making it move the heads better. In the old version, I believe in the Sundering, they had just elephant animations, so they wouldn't move their heads at all. And in the old versions of Beginning of the End Times, there were no Hydras and no dragons. I believe the old version of Beginning of the End Times did have dragons, but there were no Hydras. But Beginning of the End Times, Call of Warhammer didn't have, I believe Call of Warhammer didn't have dragons, and Beginning of the End Times added a bunch of creatures, but the Hydras, they are new for this latest 2.0 version. Okay, and the Witch Elves used to have black hair up until this version too. Okay, and this version 2.0 is slightly more recent than Alternative Cut, I believe. Because Alternative Cut released in March 2019. And this one in December or November. Okay, so, check the Vampire Coast. See that they have a bunch of new units. There are some units shared with Sylvania, but for the most part they have really cool new additions. And we have the Pestilence Skaven. They share a bunch of units, but they have unique ones too, like Plague Monks and Plague Sensor Bearers. Okay, we have a bunch of cool units. Also the models are improved. I believe the Rat Ogres and such looked way better in this version compared to in older versions, and especially in Alternative Cut. But anyway, I think we've previewed enough, and as I said, I'm not the best at speaking right now. I don't know why. I will need to go and drink something and continue, because we are not done. This is the number 7 on my top 20 list for fantasy mods of Medieval to Total War Kingdoms, but yeah, we will need to continue, and this was a very poor review. I should probably remake it, but anyway, I kind of have varied, what should I say? Some days I'm really good at speaking English, and other days I'm really bad, and probably I'm bad right now. Anyway, so Call of Warhammer, Beginning of the End Times is number 7. My top 20 list. So next one.